Hey, hey. Okay. So, I told y'all I was working on art. I've been wanting to paint so bad this whole week. And I just feel like mentally I'm just not there. Like everything that I'm starting, I don't like the way it's coming out. Plus, I'm not even, you know, there with portraits. So one of them is a portrait, which of course is the Nia Wilson. I can't even show y'all that. That's how strongly I feel about that right now. If I show y'all that painting and that piece right now, y'all gonna be like, who the fuck is that? Like, don't, you know? So I'm just waiting on that. I even just, y'all seen that this had a face a few days ago. This had a face this morning. And I just woke up and was like, no, scratch it all. Do it all over. It's not to where it needs to be. And so something came into my head. Like, I feel like I've been just trying to, you know, just move through the day, which is okay sometimes, you know, but sometimes you gotta tune in and remember to process the things you're experiencing and you're going through, good, bad, whatever, you know, the way your coffee tasted in the morning. And I'm realizing, like, I'm closing a whole bunch of chapters in my life right now. There's so many things closing for me. I'm not good with, like, letting go. I'm not good with being the person to let go. I'm not good with, like, the feeling of feeling like I'm giving up on people or things. You know, I don't like that feeling. So this is super hard for me. And it made me realize, like, I need to reflect. Like, these last 2 years have been crazy in my life. I've experienced so many things that I haven't experienced, or I haven't experienced that kind of, like, trauma in a long time, because I had created a piece, like, a level of peace for myself. And just, like, being self-aware allows you to be more prepared with the unexpected and the things you can't prepare for, if that makes sense. So I'm just like, okay, the point of this is not just art. It's not just being creative. You know, it's about me being able to reflect. So I had some key things that kept popping into my head this week that I was just like, not today. Nah, I don't want to think about it, you know? And one of the prime things that my grandfather said to me, and I believe it may have been the very beginning of this year, or it could have been the last year towards the end. And when he said it to me, I felt like offended, you know, like, it made me like I really did that. You know, I guess that's what my face looks like, because I don't know, I wasn't looking at myself, but I was like, you obviously don't know me. We obviously ain't, you feel me? You my grandmama, we obviously ain't as close as I thought we was, you know? And so what he said to me, which I feel like is so important, and I do need to constantly remember it. Now I see that he was right. You know, once I took the time to think about it, he is correct. And it's so, and actually he said it to me before, because it's so crazy the trail of events that happened after that. So, I want to speak on another situation that happened prior to him making this statement, which I was at a job, I worked at an urgent care, and I experienced, like, racism, you know? Caucasian man came in. It was just, I don't even feel like going through the whole thing. Point is, my life was threatened and all this other stuff. And I really was so, like, again, I got to this level of peace that I was not mentally, like, prepared to respond. I didn't even respond how I thought I would respond. Like, I didn't even tell my family, you know, like, certain people, like, kind of found out as things went on, and my emotions were just kind of, like, weird. But I didn't even want to tell my family, because I didn't even believe that I responded the way I responded, you know? So I feel like back in the day, when you live in an environment where you gotta, like, pick yourself up, where you gotta be prepared for anything, where it's anger, it's personalities, it's opinions, it's good days, it's all these different events around you all the time. You're not the only person. There is no solitude. Like, you're in a house with 10 to 15 people every day. It ain't like, there's like, you don't even know what your own personal thought means, you know? So back in those days, you know, back in Cali where I'm from, which is a beautiful place. Honestly, I wouldn't change nothing I've been through too. Let me put that out there right now. I wouldn't change nothing I've been through. I wouldn't take it back. It all happened for a reason. It all made me the beautiful being that I am today. But y'all, I used to be ready. Like, whoever wanted it, what's up? Okay, you know, I was never like, I didn't feel, there was a period, of course, where you realize like being defensive and trying to protect yourself, you are coming off and giving off a certain energy and fueling certain fires, you know what I mean? But honestly, I've never in my life, in my heart, ever felt like I want to go with this person, or nah, you gonna respect me, or this person's belittle, like, you know, I never felt that kind of aggression. I just happened to end up with stuff. Honestly, I'm not gonna lie, some stuff I could have prevented from getting as far as it did, but back then it was just like, you gonna know that if you're gonna mess with me, I'm gonna take it to the max, because we're not gonna do this back and forth. I don't believe in back and forth. I don't believe, oh, you poke me and then I poke you and then, oh, like, let's just keep poking each other. No. Either I fucked up and I can realize what I did and take accountability, or you need to put some fucking respect on my name, you know? And that's how I felt, like, super younger. And, skipping forward to today, being out in Vegas. Of course, I told y'all, 6 years. I just don't have that mental perspective anymore to feel the need to even be in a confrontational space. I don't even care, like... So back to the racist man. Here he is, like, you better hope I don't come back and fucking hang you, you black whore, da 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 da. Like, he's just going off at the mouth. Mind you, I'm at urgent care. I work there. I'm the only person in the front witnessing the, you know, like, minus certain patients. And then the patients in the lobby don't speak English, but this man. So I'm just like, okay, white man, you know, that was my response, because I'm not like conversationally just like, what the fuck is your problem? What the fuck you mad at? Like, who the fuck you coming in here talking to like that? Like, you ain't about to do nothing because you running your mouth. So to me, where I'm from, like, people ain't gonna come tell you, I'm gonna hang you, I'm gonna, you know, whatever, I'm gonna kick your ass. Like, no. It's just on site. So to me, it's just like, what the fuck? Like, fuck you. And then, like, after he just walked out after saying so much shit. I just, like, he was just talking. I was just pretty much letting him talk. Like, okay. Mm-hmm. And then afterwards, and I was thinking about it, like, so many of us in healthcare have to witness shit, and not even saying racist stuff, but just patients being disrespectful, patients being rude. Patients don't care because they feel like you're at work. Like, you're here to serve me, so I can treat you any kind of way I want. I don't feel good, so that gives me the right. And I don't understand that, you know? So I was thinking about that. And then I thought about the fact that, damn, what if he did come in here like, no, right now, you, let's go. You know, I'm the only person in here. Like, my family don't know where I work, you know? Like, it was just so many things that started running through my head. And it's just like, do I report this? I don't even, like, you know, it was so many different variables that made it feel like, that made me, it started to make me feel vulnerable. Like, so I didn't defend myself. Then that was the thing that kept me up, like, at night. That was the thing that, like, ate at my soul. And honestly, it'll still every so often pop up. You didn't defend yourself. You didn't, like, set any standard with this person to let them know, like, I will fuck, like, bro, I don't fear death. I don't fear anything of that nature. Like, it'll be what it is, you know? And I always have to remind myself that I didn't do that because I don't feel the need to. I feel protected in who I am. I'm confident in who I am. I'm confident in my angels, my ancestors, the universe, God. I'm confident in everything that lives within me and that has helped create me. So being at that level of peace, I didn't feel like I needed to do nothing because I didn't feel like he was an actual threat, one. Two, of course, there's always that anybody could come back and make act on their thing. You know what I mean? But it's just like, it is what it is. You know what I mean? So moving forward, we're back to my grandpa. Sorry, I feel like this is going to kind of be drawn out. I didn't realize. which I'm talkative sometimes. But getting back to my grandpa, so I have been spending half my weeks with my grandpa, half my weeks here, and that's due to a numerous of circumstances that I'm not gonna get into right now. And every so often, me and my grandpa will sit down and we will have, well, we always have conversations that are thought-provoking and just beautiful, funny, hilarious, like comforting, feel home. It's home pretty much. That's what it is. It's home for me. And one day he just walked in from outside and I was sitting in the dining room and he literally just came in and was like, "Hey, can I tell you something without you getting offended?" And I was like, "Yeah, go ahead." And he's like, "You cannot help everybody." And he said it with so much passion. Like, if you hear my, one day I'm gonna have to make a video with my grandpa so y'all can hear like the power in his voice when he speaks. He's very, he's very smooth and cool and calm and collected, but he can be very assertive with his voice and you're gonna hear him. And when he told me you can't help everybody, he made sure it was clear, like, you can't do it. You are not a superhero. Who can't help? Who? Please let me know, you know? And that's kind of like how it made me feel. Like, what you mean? Like, yes, I can. I will go above and beyond for anybody. And then after I said that in my head, because, you know, I was letting him finish his explanation, I was like, ooh, why that sound kind of... I'll go above and beyond for anybody. Something about that didn't sound right to me, so I was like, okay, let me tune back into what he's saying. And of course, you know, he's explaining to me, like, it's not about you or your capabilities or what you're able to accomplish, but you have to learn when to release. It's okay to release. It's not a bad thing to say, I need to help me, or I need to, you know, love on me. And I think that's where my balance needed to be balanced out, I guess. Because I don't, you know, like, I come from a family who is, you know, we all got our problems, but we are the most loving, affectionate people I don't even understand. Like, my grandmother, above and beyond in my childhood, if I called her, she would be on the freeway, whether she had to reach out to Billy Bob from 7 years ago who owed her, you know, whatever it was. Like, my grandma was on her way to me. My dad, if I was calling him, whatever. My mom, like, as a grown woman now, like, that is my baby. Like, I love her. I love her. I love her. And my auntie April, I could go down the whole list, y'all. My cousins, all my cousins, y'all know y'all live. My cousins, every cousin, Alaboos, Hines, everything, Burks, all of my cousins live. But it was just like having to process that. And I feel like I'm able to close so many chapters now because I manifested on that. And I kind of worked on that. When I questioned myself and I heard what he said and I listened to his explanation on it and stuff, and it makes sense. And I feel like a lot of the times for a lot of things, I was holding myself back by choosing to put other people ahead of me. Let me put their happiness before mine, you know? And there's so many different examples of that in my life. And it's so crazy. It's so many times I stayed up at night, like, panicked, panting, like, just breaking down because I felt so uncomfortable and so fucked up for not doing something for somebody because I needed to do it for myself. And it made me feel uncomfortable. And then it also puts you in this perspective where you start to see how much you give to people, because as soon as you say no to one thing, it's like, you then, woo. You know, it's all these different personalities that come out and you're like, whoa, that's how you look at me? Whoa, there's no love and respect like I'm giving you. Like, there's a time right now where I'm telling you I needed to love on myself. And instead of you giving me some love or encouraging me to do that, you want to tear me down because you can't get something out of me when I've given you everything from any encounter I can never think of. And that's across the board, you know? So that feeling, I feel like because, like, as I spoke on the other video, the previous video, I kind of I kind of grew up, I want to be careful the way I say this. I grew up with so many personalities around me that it was hard to find my own voice. So I used to feel like when I had a thought or anything, it was wrong. If I had an opinion on it, it was wrong and I needed to change it and adjust it to whatever temperature or frequency that I was around. I'm so grateful I don't fucking feel that way. So grateful, honestly. But knowing that, you know, I had to work on those things, I feel like that specific phrase, him saying that, my grandpa, he got a lot of gems. I'm gonna have to start dropping on y'all. That's my baby. But working on that helped me. And actually, the time frame don't matter at this point, but it honestly helped me so much to be able to release y'all. Like, I already had no fears with certain stuff, releasing certain things, throwing myself into certain things, just because I don't like to be stagnant. I have this thing that I constantly need to keep moving. I don't know what it is. I don't like to be attached. I gotta keep going. So it kind of helped me to be able to be comfortable with people being upset with me because I need to disconnect and focus on myself. So another thing too, moving on from that, I just need to shout out Popular Loner on YouTube. Like, this woman's videos, so I found her videos like maybe 4 days ago. And first off, I found her videos like 4 days ago and already two of her videos pinpointed me specifically, and in one of them she said my name. So she does videos on a lot of different things. So far I've only seen or watched, you know, the tarot card readings. So it's so crazy just how just on point they are. But one thing I love about tarot card readings on YouTube, which I don't watch all of them, some of them give me weird vibes, but I'm drawn to some of them, you know. And I don't like, because you know how social media will put certain videos in front of you repeatedly over and over and stuff. And what I loved about it is that her video, and there's one other person, but I have to look his name up, JD something. He's so fucking hilarious and he's amazing too. But when I listen to their videos, even if the message don't relate to me or if I feel like it's not my situation, it's the affirmations that's in it. It's the encouragement that's in it. So it reminds people to just keep looking forward. You don't have to go and look at it to look for, I want to know what my future is. You know, it doesn't have to be that kind of thing. You can actually look at them and watch them and just get encouraged throughout the day. Because honestly, I just watched one of her premieres and it just motivated me so much because I felt like, you know what? That is my thing right now. I need to be okay with releasing. Remembering to be okay with releasing. Like, honestly, just having this conversation right now has made me feel so much better because that is a huge struggle for me. Like, people can do me wrong, like, and be me over repeatedly. And if they come back and be like, I'm just so glad I'm not in that space. Because people could come back and say, you know, oh, I'm gonna really fix this. I know I was wrong with this and this is cool. And then I'd be like, okay. And then I'm in the same cycle, you know. But it's just like, oh, well, and in my head, I think about it in the sense like, well, I love my family and they do fucked up shit to me all the time. They neglect me all the time, you know, they abandon me all the time. So what's the big deal? Like, I grew up knowing abandonment. That's my comfort zone for me. Like, I like to detach because I'm used to that feeling. Now it's like, that's all I want, you know? And it's like, that's another thing that I know I have to work on in certain areas. Because I do like my space and I do think it's good. And I do think, like, it's a difference between abandonment and then the ability to, like, release things that are not feeding you. You know what I mean? In a positive way. Or that are taking from you and not giving to you. So, I wrote a few notes down here. Just to speak more on the releasing, just because I feel like so many of us do this. Like, I know me, I don't want to speak on one of my cousin's names because I just don't know, you know, I want to check with people first. But one of my cousins, like, we have both been so emotional, like, And when I say emotional, I mean it in a beautiful way, but it wasn't looked at like that growing up. In the Black community, I feel like having emotions is looked at like, either it's like, oh, you a girl, you know, so, huh, you're just saying girl shit, I'm not even caring about what you're saying. Or it's like, nigga, man up. The fuck you mean you feel? What the fuck is feel, you know? And my cousin, I was so connected to her because she was the first person that I experienced who felt the same things I felt without me having to say it, you know? And of course, that's your big cousin, so you kind of just already look up to them kind of thing. But she's honestly always been so, such a great example for me to look back at when reflecting on my life, when I get to a rock and a hard place, you know? I think back to when we were younger and who we are as adults now. I may not communicate with this cousin like frequently now for like the past 2-3 years, but up until that moment, like just to see her transition even then, and just like our journeys and the different things that we go through, the different ways we were raised, and you know, even though we were raised very similar, like we grew up in my grandma's house with all our cousins the same weekend, every weekend, if not every weekend, every week. Sometimes we live there for periods, and you know, so it's just like to see how much we've blossomed and we've grown to self-understanding is beautiful and amazing, because so many times, I'm gonna speak on me now at this point, not with both of us, but so many times in like my childhood alone, I just felt like something was wrong with me. Like, why is this affecting me but nobody else is affected? Like, why y'all don't feel that this person feels weird? Like, something is weird with them. Like, we need to put stranger danger on, kind of thing, you know? And it's just so beautiful to be able to be at a point of releasing. So honestly, I feel so good. I might paint. This feels so much better. Fuck, maybe I need to go to therapy, y'all. But I don't like talking to people. I don't trust people. And I used to do like counseling and stuff when I was younger, you know. My mom had put me in it really young. And I enjoyed it. I believe his name was Dr. Tavipi. He was super awesome. I'm so sorry if I butchered his name, but he was so awesome. Such a powerful Black man. That's another thing too. Like, I want to say something, but I don't want it to sound weird. I feel like, and not that I don't learn things, because I've learned so many things from the women in my family, but I feel like when I interact with an intelligent man, a Black man in particular, you know, who has his, and when I say intelligent, I'm not saying that, you know, anybody is not intelligent or anything of that sort. I'm speaking with the intelligence to be self-aware and to be at peace within himself. Because I feel like a lot of the times in our communities and our families, like, not only are our women not at peace, our men are not at peace too. Like, we are all looking for peace and bumping against each other, you know, either helping or hindering that peace. It's like, if you know how molecules, how we're made up of like different molecules and cells and how they bump against each other all the time. Like, that's what it is. And just interacting and hearing him when I was younger, being able to be honest and say, you know, this is what I feel. This is what's going on. Like, and I feel crazy. And then for him to say, you know what, Sierra, actually, I think I understand what you're saying, but I feel like if you would have done it and communicated it in this way, it would have been able to register a little bit more. Or for him to be like, no, you are not wrong in this. That is the best way you could have done it. And although your outcome may not be what you want it to be, you did what you could. You left behind and you spoke with love. You spoke from compassion. That's all you can be and that's all you want to be. So you did what you needed to do. You stood up for yourself. You did it respectfully, you know? So he helped encourage me too to find my voice. And I just think that it's so monumental and it's so important for men and women to interact with one another on a positive, like, aspect. Honestly, I genuinely, like, feel that in so many ways. Honestly, I really feel like we all need to, like, get together right now. Let's all just, like, jot down a few thoughts, jot down a few, you know, like, let's compliment each other, let's uplift each other, let's encourage each other, let's listen. Like, every time I go to a job interview, every time I interact with people, I always talk about listening. Because that is the most important skill I learned. And thank God that I did go through the feelings of abandonment or the feelings of not being heard. Because it made me more self-aware, which I know is not like that for everybody. Some people take that and be like, oh, you didn't hear me? Well, fuck it, I ain't gonna hear nobody. You feel me? Like, blah, blah. But for me, I feel like it helped me realize that I want to listen to other people. I want to hear what other people have to say. I think stories are beautiful. I think I can learn. I learn stuff from people all the time. All the time. All the time. And I love it. And I know and I feel people learn from me all the time. I feel their energy. I just realized I don't even got my damn light on. Ooh. It's been a long, long time. Got this message for you all. Mm. But it seems I was there a long time. But still, I wanna get through to you all. Mm-hmm. You gonna make your debut, Kingy? My little Kingy boy. Give you some love. Even though mommy can't sing, he love when mommy sings. Some good loving. Oh, I, oh, I, oh, I. Say hi, Kingy Bud. Okay, let mommy finish because this video is already 27 minutes long. Ugh. So yeah, I think everybody, like, is so important. My overall feeling right now for myself. Is it so important for me to listen to my body? After that experience with my grandpa and him saying that to me, then at the beginning of the year in January 31st, my little brother, my little brother came out here and I was so fucking excited. Y'all, I've been manifesting for my siblings for like 2 years. I've been manifesting to have my siblings, to hold my siblings, to kiss my siblings, to encourage them, to be a part of their journey. Like, it honestly, as a kid, that was the one thing that kept me, and I know this is gonna probably sound really crazy or like really deep, but that was the only thing that kept me from like offing myself, honestly, because I felt like if this is what I'm going through, I can only imagine what my siblings are gonna have to go through. I wanna know that they have some fucking little gem of light. You know, whether I'm helping them, encouraging them, teaching them something, whatever the hell it is, I want some little gem of light for them just in case. You know, I know there's a ton of family and people around who love and care, but I also know what it's like when you go into different stuff, and I know what our situations were. And on all sides, you know, and not saying that anything was terrible or anything like that. You know, my parents, their parents are awesome. You know, I have split siblings. To me, they're full siblings, but I know some people call them like half siblings or whatever. I have brothers on my dad's side who have different moms, and I have brother and sister on my mom's side who have a different dad. And then I also have two step siblings. Well, I have one step sibling. I have another sibling that I just gravitated to. So yeah, and I'm the oldest of all of them. So, imagine already, that's a lot, because I grew up in a house with two siblings, and then I always felt like because I grew up in a house with two siblings, I felt weird or like I was doing something wrong because I didn't get to see my other siblings every day. And mind you, I'm so young to even think about all this pressure that I was putting on myself. All these things that I was exposed to and I knew of, and it stressed me out. It broke my heart. Like, I was trying to be an adult, like, young as I don't know what. Like, I don't know what. I was so young, like, stressing. Like, I used to stress and, like, call, and, like, people would be like, oh, what do you want for Christmas? I just want to get my siblings, blah, blah, blah. Like, no, you can't do that. What do you want? And that used to piss me off. Like, it used to make me mad. Like, how you gonna tell me I can't give my gift to, or I can't, you feel me? What you mean? Then it ain't my gift. Then it's whatever you want to give me. You gonna give me some funky ass socks anyway, you know? Like, But, you know, I understand why they was doing it. Of course, that's just a kid's mentality. But I've been manifesting my siblings so hard. And honestly, over the last 2 years, I've been able to interact with them, like, each one's on different times, different events, and it's been so beautiful to me. And then I even had a moment where when I went to California, not the last time, because actually the last time was 2 weeks ago, and not the time before that, because that was my dad's wedding. The time before that, I went to California, and I was actually able to have one of my brothers on my dad's side interact and meet my he met my mom and stuff before, and he's seen them when they was younger, but it's been so many years. But come to my mom's house and interact with my brother and sister there, my auntie, like, went down certain memories from when we was younger and stuff, and then we was able to teach my sister stuff. Like, it was just so, honestly, it was so fucking nostalgic for me. That was everything I needed in my life. That was what fueled me for the next few months. And then back to what happened after my grandpa gave me that, which was, you cannot help everybody, right? So I already knew I wanted to make a certain change in my life, and I was already trying to figure out how to communicate that in a way that I felt comfortable, and I also felt like I wasn't hindering or disrespecting anybody. And boom, my brother comes out here, and that night he gets there, that next morning we get ready to go to the store to remove money from the ATM, which I don't want to go into the details of the situation, but point is, there was a whole false arrest, like 7-8 cop trucks, a helicopter, heck of stuff, accusing, like, trying to accuse everybody at first of stealing a car, and then they realized, like, there was no girl, so they, like, took me out, and they took my brother, and then my boyfriend at the time, too. And it was so, like, honestly, it was like the worst fucking feeling that I could experience as an adult for me. And I don't even, fuck, this is hella annoying. I don't even want to be emotional about it, but honestly, to have to be in a situation where you literally can't help the people you love who are standing on the side of you, it's just crazy. And then to see how immune to it my brother was, and to think about, like, this is literally the first day that I'm able to, like, interact with him after so many years, and this is what's happening. Like, whoa. This is, like, I have to witness my brother being put in handcuffs. I have to witness my boyfriend at the time being put in handcuffs, you know, and being, like, you know, he, one is flipping out on this side, the other one's on this side, and Marcel's, I mean, my brother's calm. My dog is flipping out, like, I'm in cuffs. The last time I was in cuffs, again, was an incorrect arrest when I was in, like, the sixth grade. This dude was, like, shooting staples and shit at my ass in downtown Oakland. Kept smacking my ass. And I told him, like, if you touch my ass again, I'm going to beat your ass. Like, we're going to fight. And he's like, you know, did it again. And we start fighting. And I whooped his ass. And because I was whooping his ass, I got arrested, even though everybody down there was like, nah, he was physically assaulting her. And they still took me, and it was just like, because thank God that they was able to get a hold of my mom and figure out that I was a minor and whole other shit, they ended up taking me back to my school, which was, like, down the block, and I didn't, like, have anything go any further. But that was super traumatic for me too, because instead of in that moment, like, being heard out, I was ridiculed, I was punished, and then I was punished again at school because the principal was there. Then I was punished again with my mom, and it was just like nobody across the board or in my family even took time to hear me out, you know? they kind of all just assumed that, oh, okay. Except my dad. Solid ass. When I, you know, I was my best friend when I was a kid, because my dad, he knew everything. I told my dad everything. But back to the fucking point. Yeah, that moment with my brother, it broke my heart, because it sunk in. Like, honestly, it didn't even traumatize my brother. Well, I feel like I know it affects him. He just hang on me, you know? I just know. I know it affects him in different ways, though. But he was just so tough about it, and like, you need to calm down, sis. Like, you gotta relax. And it's just like, I fucking love you. Like, if I didn't believe, because they already had us in cuffs, if I didn't believe that me reacting crazy wouldn't have affected him or like them, I would have lost my shit. Like, I would have took that chance. I would have did whatever, like, you know. But I felt like, you don't know how it's about to turn out right now. Be patient, be cool, you know, like, try and chill. Like, my whole spirit was just so rattled. And it was the first time I ever had to experience that, and to experience it with my siblings, that's like my greatest fear. And then on top of that, it's like, already in my family, like, to think that one of my cousins have had to endure that, to think about just all, well, we've all lost people at different times, but recently, like, this is, it's just too much. Like, it was just so, it was so much. That was so hard for me. But it's true. And we go through things with a purpose, you know what I mean? And that's okay, you know? But that experience, like, it made me even madder to hear my grandpa phrase after that, because I was pissed. I was pissed. I had an attitude with him. Well, I didn't like express it to him or anything. But I was really at home like, you said this. You put this into fruition, you know? And it's like, no, he was preparing you. Mentally preparing you, like, God was speaking through him to prepare you for what was about to happen. And just holding on to that, going through that experience, having to battle like the pain of it by myself, which is typical, that's what I would prefer, honestly, anyway. But being around people and having to battle that by myself, everybody just kind of like, this happens all the time. It's like, well, nigga, let's stop accepting it. Why we want to keep accepting it if this shit is happening all the time? Like, y'all don't want to do a different reaction, you know? Nobody, no one else in our, you know? And then it was another, it's a whole another thing too, to think that, dang, it's people in my family who know this thing has happened and has not once called to say, check, speak, question, anything. But then you see them like, oh, the church is in need of help. The church, go door to door, go to your family's house, help your family. It starts at home, you know. But it's not my place to tell people what their journey is. Just like, sometimes I can't always be there and help other people, you know. So it's just a whole mental fuckery. And I think just reflecting back over everything that I'm releasing over this time, like, I didn't realize how much I was holding my motherfucking breath. Literally. Like, holding my breath just to get by. I didn't even, like, I knew it was coming to a point where I was gonna have to, you know, deal with things. And I deal with them little by little, but really take time to process the emotions and how it affects me. And that's not even, honestly, that ain't even everything that's happened. It's been so much stuff, because then right after they got released, the next morning we woke up. Well, it wasn't even the morning. It was like, well, it was early morning. It was like the early 2 a.m. We woke up to gunshots and stabs and shit from upstairs. And I don't mean that to say that disrespectfully, because I'm sorry for the family who lost. But upstairs, there was someone who was murdered. And we woke up to their blood splattered on the floor, like, and on the door, dripping from the stairs that next morning, like. And then stuff happened every day for like the next 2 weeks, dude. Like, so much stuff. And not only that, but then you have your normal life, then you have work, then you have family, then you have like relationships long overdue kind of stuff. So it's just like, then still then when you're a healer and you're still being a support to someone, to others, period, you know, just releasing is so important. It's okay to not be able to help everybody. It's okay to have to help yourself. It's okay to just love on yourself. It's okay to remove people, things, experiences. I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's a job and you don't know how you're gonna make your rent, whatever. If you are so unhappy and discomforted to where your mental peace is disrupted, release that shit. Put in the work, release that shit. I am quick when it comes to a job. I don't even care if I got one lined up, which is, that ain't what my parents taught me. I ain't gonna be front with you. That ain't what they taught me, but I'm so highly blessed and favored that I can do that and bounce back with a job before the next month. So thank you, God, you know, cause that ain't nothing but God. But honestly, like, it's okay to release everybody. And it's okay to release Sierra. So when I watch this later, if I ever get down, it's okay. Release. Drop them bags off, sis. Move the fuck on. Sorry, y'all. I know I can't sing, but it's okay. So yeah, and it's so cool. I specifically sat here so that way I can kind of emphasize my little painting here that is still unfinished. However, can I zoom in? Nope, I cannot. I shall take it down. So, this has literally been like my last 2 years. You know, there's fucking meteors hitting me. There's octopuses climbing up my leg, trying to convert me. There's fucking growth mentally, spiritually. I am understanding that I am water, as I have stated to you all before, utilizing that ability, just trying to communicate with things beyond the human flesh and our existence, period. All things are in motion. There's multiple things happening on a daily basis. And I feel like this was a release for me just to kind of remind myself that all these little things are literally less than a grain of sand compared to the world that is existing. My purpose is somewhere in all of this chaos, unfinished chaos, and it is not to be anybody's, you know, doormat. It's not to be anyone's personal cheerleader that sits in their bathroom by the mirror. Hey girl, you're beautiful. Hey girl, you got this. You know, I'm gonna be my own cheerleader. I'm gonna cheer for everybody too. Cheer for everybody, be my own cheerleader, but first for me to help and affect, I gotta be, you know, on my stuff. So yeah, you can't help everybody. You are not a superhero. My grandfather said it first and he correct. And ride the wave. Great outro song. Oh, and also too, this is another depiction, y'all. I was so silenced, but not no more. Look at the fucking little jellyfish and everything helping my little black self. Look, just helping me. communication. I hadn't even realized how much art I was producing about communicating, and I was not even like understanding how much was in my heart and how much I was trying to like learn. It's so crazy. You are my fire. And then of course my uncle. Oh, that's so crazy. This is my brother. When he was, well, this is a painting I did of my brother. And this is the jacket that they kept saying that this was the reason why they felt like he stole the car. There was a white jacket, black man in a white jacket. And this is what my little brother had on. However, that was a huge puff jacket. He wasn't running, he had on slides. None of us was running. Like, I told him I lived right up the hill. It was just, it was so much stuff. Honestly, I still wanna sue. I still wanna sue Las Vegas Metro Police Department. Yep. Still do. But have a great evening, guys. I promise I'm gonna get some art going. I'm feeling really good, really rejuvenated. All this good music too. Music is everything. Music is life, and it's meant to be played loud. Shout out to Seta for that last part. Talk to y'all later.